Hello and welcome to Dude's Comic Reviews. I'm Jason, the dude in question, and this is my weekly video where I review the comic books I picked up this week. I will go through them, I will pick out my pick of the week, I will also pick out my cover of the week, and I will also do my geek out moment, which is that moment that really impacted me that I liked from a comic this week. Each review I try and keep as concise as I can while saying all the things I feel I need to say about that book. So, without further ado, let's get straight to those reviews. First up this week, we have X-Men, Wolverine and the X-Men, issue number 35. This features the conclusion to the Hellfire saga. I mentioned in my haul video that this was one that I was seriously thinking about dropping, and I'd pretty much made that decision. This issue has made me rethink that a little bit. It's a really satisfying conclusion to the story. It sets up the new status quo. A few characters come to the end of the journey they've been on. In particular, Quentin Quire, who I think Jason has done a tremendous job with over a long period of time of having this character mature and grow. And you see, I kind of see the final stages of that here. And it's going to be interesting to see what happens with him and the other characters from now on. Because there are a lot of characters who their story sort of comes to a head here. And like I said before, sets for new status quo and gives us the direction we're going to go in the future. It certainly was very satisfying for me as a long time reader of the book, as a lot of things got rounded off, but also it made me excited for the future and kind of want to see how this is going to turn out. So, you know, I definitely was a lot more on board with this. The art was a bit there were parts where the art seemed like it had been a bit rushed and there wasn't the detail you'd expect. But, like, come on, Bradshaw's done, like, 5 issues in probably, you know, 2 months. And so, you know, you can forgive him a little bit on the art because that's a lot of issues to kind of have to put out in that short space of time. But, yeah, I really like the whole direction of this. Really like where it's going. And it's definitely made me think maybe I keep on the book. I don't know. But it's definitely given me something to think about. And I give Wolverine and the X-Men, issue number 35, 5 stars. Next we have FF, issue number 11. I said before that that I really enjoyed the kids the most out of this book, but this issue we rip a lot less of the kids than we usually do, and we focus a lot more on our Fantastic Four team. And actually it's the first time that I feel really felt engaged and really like the team, and I feel the team was beginning to come into its own. You've got that bit of banter going on between She-Hulk and Miss Thing, which I kind of really like because it reminds you of Thing and Human Torch from the original Fantastic Four. But for the mid star of this issue was Medusa. They're dealt with a problem here. They have an old character called Impossible Man comes into the book again, and the situation they're kind of put in, Medusa, that is, uses her smarts to kind of think her way out of it and help somebody who's in pain and help, you know, and talk away and come use an intellectual way to get out of it rather than brute force. And I really like that. I felt that was a very kind of Fantastic Four thing to do, and I really liked, you know, I really endeared Medusa a lot more to me. So yeah, I really enjoyed that aspect of it. I thought Impossible Man was a great villain to kind of, not really a villain, but a great character to throw in there. And yeah, I this was the first time I've read the book where I've really felt, yeah, I really like this team, and it's really becoming together. There's lots of things building in the background. This issue, particularly, we have the alien who impersonated Julius Caesar, and Magnus the Mad. There's something going on with them too. So I like that we've got things kind of bubbling. And the joy about this book is that even when, like, they have your danger and peril and foreboding things building, there's still an overriding sense of fun to the book, which I think really endears it to me. And I give FF issue number 11 5 stars. So, next up we have Star Wars Legacy, issue 6 and issue 5. Talking about issue 5 first, Star Wars Legacy, it's set 138 years after A New Hope, and it features the relation of Han and Leia, Anya Solo, And she's like, there's a lot of things kind of about her that remind me of Luke Skywalker from that original Star Wars film. How Luke was working on his uncle's moisture farm and Tatooine. And then they buy these droids and they take him to this Jedi Knight. And he gets wrapped up in these great galactic events that sort of go down in the book. And in this, it very much seems like Anya was running her scrapyard. And then she gets mixed up with this Jedi that leads her on this great grand adventure. So I enjoyed, you know, the story. I tell you how much I enjoyed the story. I was like halfway through the book and I was just so into it. I was enjoying it. I cared about the characters. I was concerned who was going to die, who was going to live. Because it's the final part of a 5-issue arc. But it still was so welcoming to new readers. And I just was totally straight into it. It did a great job of getting you into it. And that's great work on the writer's part to make it that accessible to new readers. The characters are brilliant. You've got Anya, Solo, who's got wrapped up with this Jedi. His Jedi Master has been kidnapped by this Sith Lord. So Anya's helping him to try and rescue this Jedi Master from this Sith Lord. But on here, this Sith Lord seems to have gone public and he's going to execute this Jedi Master. Like a public execution, if you will, and Anya's got to try and stop it, but all her friends are injured and she's got to kind of try and get away out of this. What I really love were the supporting cast. You have this assassin droid, which I've always loved the assassin droids, and also you got this Mon Calamari called Sook, I think that's how you pronounce it, and Mon Calamari, he's one of the best aliens any TV show has ever created. I just love the look of the Mon Calamari. For those of you that are not, that kind of think of Admiral Ackbar from Return of the Jedi. He was a Mon Calamari. So, yeah, I just really, really enjoyed the book. I liked the cast. I immediately sort of took to the cast and cared about them. And it was a really fun, action-packed issue. And it definitely, definitely got me into it. So I'd give issue number 5 of Star Wars Legacy 5 stars. So then we move on to issue number 6, which is the issue that came out this week. And this issue is kind of like all the fallout from that first story arc, while at the same time setting up where the book is going next. There's some interesting developments in this book, as the Sith Lord, who escaped at the end of issue number 5, he's now going around. The universe has changed, where in the past there was only ever 2 Sith, a master and an apprentice, one to have power, one to crave power. But the Sith have changed in all the years since, and now there's loads of Sith, and they've infiltrated all these different governments. But this one Sith Lord that we met, I can't pronounce his name properly, but I think it was something like Darth Red, but it was like a double, it's red, but then there's a W on the front, so I'm not 100% sure. If that makes a lot of difference, if it still sounds like Red. But he is basically Darth Red. He's going around killing all these Sith Lords who have infiltrated these governments. Because he wants to get back to the old ways of there being just 2 Sith Lords. And so like the government are kind of stuck with this situation. Like, well, should we stop him? He's killing people, but he's killing all these Sith that have infiltrated all these different governments. He's doing our job for us. So should we turn a blind eye to this and let him carry on? And kind of puts them in an ethically interesting situation, and kind of their decision then pushes Anya and the Jedi Knight that she was helping before, it kind of puts them in like the situation of like, should we let Red get away, or what should we do? Because they've kind of been given things to kind of distract them, and to go, you know, so that this sort of thing doesn't go public. So there's some really interesting developments and setting it up for the future. And then at the end, when they make the decision on what they're going to do, there's a really interesting twist. So yeah, I enjoyed this one as well. I didn't enjoy it as much as issue number 5. I thought issue number 5, there's a lot more action. This is very much more setting things up. But it was still an enjoyable issue. And I think it's a great place to jump on if this is a book that's really taking your fancy. And if you like Star Wars, I think you'll like this book. Really good. Some really interesting things going on, and I give Star Wars Legacy issue number 6 4 stars. So next, my pick of the week, and it is for God of Thunder issue number 12. Another really great issue. This is the sixth issue in a row that it's got pick of the week. And I thought with all the Gore, the God Butcher stuff finished, I was a bit concerned about the book, whether it could keep it up. Did Jason Aaron have another Thor story in him? And, you know, I was wrong. And anybody who dropped this book because they were concerned what they were going to get now, you missed out on a really great issue. Because I would say, for me, this is the best issue thus far. One of the best books I've read this year. It is really good. The basic premise of the story is it's Thor always returns to Midgard. So after the whole Gore the God Butcher stuff, we have young Thor, we have Thor the Avenger, our modern day Thor, and Thor, King Thor, the future. And they're each returning to their times, and, you know, each of them are returning to Midgard. And the bulk of the story is taken with Avenger Thor, as he returns to Midgard, and he goes and catches up with people, and there's moments in the book that are really funny. And there were moments in the book that really are heart-wrenching. The moment when he goes to see his former love, Jane Foster, and sees what's happened to her, and he kind of wants to help, but she won't let him, and he feels so helpless. And you've got this god who can move mountains, but he feels so helpless, so depowered. And I just thought that was a fantastic moment that really humanized Thor, and was just brilliant. And it just really pulled at your heartstrings, and I just think it was a fantastic bit of writing. And the art here by Clean as well, this new artist comes in, as much as I like Isad Ribic, this artist does a really good job coming in, doing this issue, and yeah, the book just all in all is just really, really great. Like I say, story makes you laugh and cry, and I'm really looking forward to what Aaron's got in store for us now, because we could be reading the definitive Thor. You know, it could be years to come, people say, what's the best Thor run? And they'll say Jason Aaron. Because if the first 12 issues are anything to go by, this could be one of the greatest runs in comics. Because I'm just really loving the series. And it just seems to constantly get better. You just don't think he can top himself, and he does. And Jason Aaron just really seems to have a real affinity for this character. Like you always have some writers like Ed Brubaker really got Captain America, and Peter David really got the Hulk, and those, for those characters, those were the best writers. And for Thor God of Thunder, I've got to say, so far I think Jason Aaron is definitely making a case for being the best writer on the book ever, and I'm really looking forward to seeing where this is going to go, hoping it keeps up the good times. But Thor God of Thunder, issue number 12, not only my pick of the week, it also gets 5 stars. So, next up we have Uncanny Avengers, issue number 11, and this issue slows things down a bit as our villains, the Apocalypse Twins, try and talk Scarlet Witch into doing, in helping them with their plan and kind of going along with them. And it's nice, sometimes it's nice when you have these issues, particularly with complex stories, where everybody can catch their breath and kind of get what's going on, and this is that kind of issue. Rick Remender, he's writing quite a complex kind of story. There's a lot of time travel elements that always make the story a bit complex. It's a good story, don't get me wrong, but it is nice. I think I enjoyed the fact that we got kind of an issue to kind of get together what's happening here, what their plan is, what's happening and everything. So I like that. He still gets moments to go around the entire team and give everybody their moment. That's why I still say Rick Remender is the best writer of team books, because every character gets their time to shine. You've got like the Horsemen of Death are just kicking ass, and there's some really great scenes there. A lovely scene between Rogue and Sunfire that I really liked. And could we have a bit of romance between those characters? I don't know. But yes, so all in all, it's another really good issue. Loving the work of Daniel Acuna. Don't know how much longer we got him on the book, but his artwork is just fantastic. I'm just, every issue, I'm falling more in love with that artwork. Yeah, and it's just all around your usual Rick Remender goodness, and I'm looking forward to where this one's going, and I give issue number 11 of Uncanny Avengers 5 stars. So next we have Captain America issue number 10, which is the conclusion of the Dimension Z storyline. This was a fantastic issue. I've really been enjoying this whole Dimension Z story. I came onto it late, but I've been able to catch up, and I think it's really been a good run. Loads of shocking stuff happening, and this issue is no exception. Once again, you know, you just don't know up until the end who's going to get out, you know. You're pretty sure Cap's going to make it out of Dimension Z, but who else will make it? Will Sharon Carter make it? Will Jet Black make it? Will Armin Zola make it? So yeah, it's really, really cool. There's some great twists and turns as the story goes along. There's a couple of particular big moments that I think in another week would probably have got Geek Out Moment of the Week, because they were big moments, and if you read the book, you can probably guess what those moments are. But I just really enjoying this. I kind of blow hot and cold on the art of Romita. Sometimes I kind of really love it and I think it really works, and then there's other times where I'm like, it doesn't look so good. So, like I say, I blow hot and cold on that, but the actual story I just think has been brilliant. It's really pushed Cap in an interesting and different kind of direction, and I'm really excited to see what's going to happen next, because very much like Thor, this book has just been all this story. Like Thor was all the God Butcher storyline all the way up to like the current issue. It's been that story, so it's interesting to see what's going to come next. Since the whole Marvel Now range of books launched, this has just been all Dimension Z. So it's going to be really interesting where they're going to take Cap next and what kind of adventures we're going to have now that he's back on Earth. But yeah, all in all, I really enjoyed this book, and I would give Captain America issue number 10 5 stars. Next we have issue number 8 of The Secret Avengers, and I've really been enjoying this book. Nick Spencer's doing a great job on it. He's writing in a book that's really different. The thing I never you know, I always kind of for some reason think of Spencer as a bit of a serious kind of guy. But he's quite wacky in his own way, and there's some really funny moments in this issue. We totally follow Mockingbird, who's disguised as an AIM scientist on AIM Island, and she's kind of been left behind, and she doesn't know, you know, they've wiped the memories of that she was working for S.H.I.E.L.D. and she was there on a mission. They've wiped all those memories, so she's kind of coming to terms with that. She's Mockingbird, but she's in this man's body, or at least she doesn't know that there's this camouflage thing that has camouflaged her. So she's kind of getting, thinks she's got mental trauma, where she's got thinking she's Mockingbird when she's not, and she's coming to terms with that. So that was kind of cool. Like I said, there's some funny moments in here, some wackiness, but also it's really interesting to see what life is like on AIM Island for all the different AIM scientists. And he does bring the funny this issue, as we get some really, you know, quite comical moments. I kind of had mixed feelings on the whole comedy, because I think in the past, AIM have been very much the butt of jokes, and they've been a very comical kind of group that have kind of been looked down upon and laughed at. And I felt what Spencer had done in this book is he really put a bit of menace back into AIM in the story. Where this issue, we kind of step back into the comedy realm. So I kind of had mixed feelings about the comedy. But it was really interesting to see what life on AIM Island is like. And I'm really, really leaves you on a good cliffhanger. And like, what's going to happen to Mockingbird? How is she going to get out of this situation? Because it kind of, things aren't looking good for her, you know. But all in all, yeah, it was another good issue. I'm a bit concerned because coming up, I think it's issue 10. We've got a tie-in with Infinity, which I'm not reading. So I'm not going to buy issue 10, but I don't know if I'm going to keep buying this book then, because it's going to take me out of my regular story. We will see. But so far, I've been enjoying this book, and I give issue number 8 of Secret Avengers 5 stars. Now, our penultimate review this week is The Flash issue number 23. It is also my cover of the week. Pretty much, I really like Manapul's art, and I'm pretty sure that is Manapul who drew this. But also, what I really liked about it, for me, it had a bit of an old school feel, where, you know, I can remember as a kid going to get my comics, and they would have something that happened inside the book on the cover, and kind of got you excited for the book, and this very much does, as you have inside the battle that we see on the cover between Reverse Flash and The Flash. So yeah, the story itself is really good. We get the big reveal of this issue over the identity of Reverse Flash, which I liked. It made sense, and it kind of had been set up, so I thought that was really cool. It ends, as always, on a great cliffhanger where you want to see what happens next. I think the two writers, Manapul and Bucciolato, they do such a great job of like building up those cliffhangers. Every issue you just, it leaves you wanting more, and I think every book, its primary function should be to make you want to buy the next one, and this book seems to always do that. Art once again is fantastic, and it's just an all-round really great read, and I look forward to every month And I give The Flash issue number 23 not only my cover of the week, I also give it 5 stars. And finally this week, my Geek Out Mom of the Week is Justice League issue number 23, the conclusion to Trinity War. Oh my god, wow. Double wow, this was good. On any other week, if you didn't have the excellence that is Four Gotta Funded, this would have got Pick of the Week. Right up until I read Four, this was like going to be my Geek Out moment and my Pick of the Week. Four pipped it for Pick of the Week, but Geek Out moment, this is it. And I can't pick one moment. The whole issue is just one great big Geek Out moment. As you gain all these twists and turns, you get the answers to the questions, you get the answer to what Pandora's box is, you get the answer to who that mysterious guy behind the Secret Society is, you get the important what the between the significance of Trinity, everything gets answered, you get the answer to what's wrong with Superman, and what happened, why did he kill Dr. Light, everything gets answered in this issue, and everything makes sense. And that's the brilliant. When you get things that you never saw coming, but it makes sense, that is just fantastic. I was just geeking out totally for this one. Really loved it. It was really good. And I just loved the direction it took. It made sense. The whole Villains Month thing and Forever Evil, the miniseries that's coming, all of that just all made sense. You know, and it was like, you know, we all knew the destination. We all knew where we were going to end up. But like the way it all became realized, I never imagined. It was fantastic, made total sense. I'm repeating myself now because I just really enjoyed this book, and I'm finding it difficult to articulate myself in ways that don't keep repeating the same words. Yeah, I really enjoyed this. I don't know if you're picking that up, but yeah, this was great. So, and I'm really super psyched now for Forever Evil, which starts next week. So yeah, this was another really great issue. They've done such a great job on this series. So pleased to see Ivan Reis get to kind of draw all these A-list superheroes, because I'm a big fan of his. I think his artwork's fantastic. He's been doing a great job for the first year of the New 52 on Aquaman. And it's great to see when people do great work. It's great to see them being rewarded by getting a bigger book. And so like, I'm really chuffed to see him on this. And I think this was all round just was really great. And I give Justice League issue number 23, not only do I give it my Geek Out Moment of the Week, but I also give it a big stonking 5 stars.